nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.2. So in the last lecture, we were talking about different ways of solving ordinary differential equations. And that was kind of setting the stage to understand the leapfrog method. And that plays an important role in the finite difference time domain method. And so if you look at Maxwell's equations, you notice that it has spatial derivatives as well as time derivatives. And furthermore, if you compare this to kind of the well-known Maxwell's equations, there are a couple of changes. Of course, this is Faraday's law here, dB dt equals minus curl v. But then you also subtract these extra two terms, which are fictitious magnetic current and fictitious magnetic conductivity. So why are we doing that? That allows us to absorb light that we don't want to bounce back into our region of interest. Okay, so that doesn't exist in a physical region of space. And then the second equation, this is Ampere's law. Of course, with Maxwell's correction, dd by dt, also known as the displacement current. And then there's this extra term here, which is the material absorption, which is commonly present if you have Ohm's law in the material, right? So for a conductor, like a metal. And then you have these two auxiliary equations, of course, which define the relationship between displacement field and electric field, basically D equals epsilon E, and then the H field equals the magnetic field B divided by mu, the permeability. So then this is actually a complete set of equations we need in order to solve Maxwell's equations directly. So of course, I mentioned the independent variables are time and space. So we can actually extend the ODE methods we talked about in the last lecture by having the two solution methods in ODEs talk to each other. So basically, the communication strategy would be first, we put all the E and H fields on a Yee lattice, which I mentioned last time. And then we make sure that the neighbors can communicate, and then we would alternate the updating of E and H fields using a leapfrog method. And so if we take Maxwell's equations I showed you earlier, and then we drop some of the terms that are not absolutely necessary at the moment, just break it down to essentially the most basic terms. So it's essentially dropping current, any free current or bound current, as well as any free charges or bound charges, okay? And so we're just breaking it down to Faraday's law and then Ampere's law with Maxwell's correction without any free current. And so we get this pair of equations, basically. And so if you look at this pair of equations, it's actually not too complicated. So you could imagine that you could take the E fields and H fields and then discretize them on a 1D chain. Okay. And so this is actually showing like kind of how you can represent everything. It's essentially like the 1D E lattice, but with time also plotted here, right? And so you have like basically the E fields at these discretized points along the position axis, right? Remember it's 1D. And then you have the H fields also along the position axis, but they're offset by half a grid point. Okay, so then that's why this is at m minus 1, this m minus 1 half, this is at m, this is m plus 1 half, this is m plus 1. But then as you propagate through time, then you write difference equations like at each of these intermediate points, okay? And then this allows you to propagate into time for the hy. And so then you actually end up with equations for the updated hy at a time, which we write as q plus 1 half, as a function of the original h field at q minus 1 half. And of course, if you go back far enough, presumably the h fields will be zero. And then as a basically as a function of the original value plus this extra term that looks something like delta t over delta x times the difference between the adjacent e fields. Right. So in other words, this is a relatively straightforward implementation of Faraday's law. And the overall set of update equations we get basically are the one that I mentioned earlier, plus an update law that's based on Ampere's law with Maxwell's correction, and it looks something like this. And so you can easily work that out from the previous equation. And then we can solve these at alternating time. So this is very analogous to the ODE solution for classical mechanics that we mentioned earlier. And again, it should have second order accuracy. But then this gives rise to a logical question, which is like, how do we actually address these kind of issues when we go to higher dimensions? So of course, that's where the Yee lattice comes in. And I mentioned that we were basically looking at a 1D Yee lattice before, where E and H were staggered by half a grid point. So now we're going to actually stagger E and H by half a grid point in all three dimensions. And so then that means that like we'll have all the E fields on the edges. Okay, so if you look at this box here, you can see all the E fields are in red. And so you have essentially EX here, EY here, EZ here, and so on. And then you have H fields on the faces in blue. So here, here, and here. And then this allows you to get the maximum benefit from the leapfrog method in all dimensions at the same time. In the next lecture, we'll talk more about how to do the 3D finite difference time domain implementation.